That we saw on Monday, just for the ones who weren't here. So the main point was to distinguish between what's diegetic and what's non-diegetic. So the diegetic music is the one that happens in the scene that's on the screen, as opposed to, but let people enter, this is like the preamble. And the extra diegetic music, it's the not on the screen music, like one that sounds and that the characters can't hear, right? So this is really the essential distinction between the two. And we discussed that it's a convention that we have extra diegetic music or non-diegetic music on the film due to historical reasons that at the end of the 19th century, when cinema started, there was what was called the melodrama, which is theater with music. And during the silent period of cinema, there was music that was accompanying the images, because otherwise it sounded, it was like a phantasmagoric. It was weird to see these images moving without any sound at all. And we also talked about well, mixing, which is just the level of music towards in comparison to the rest of sounds. And the term of auricularization, it always takes me a lot of time to pronounce it in any language, which is the fact that we are aware that the music sounds in a space, in a place, or that the music is non-auricularized. That means, like, when we are hearing, listening to a CD with headphones, it's this sensation. The music is everywhere, and it's nowhere specific. You know, it's something that floats around. For instance, when we have also a non-diegetic voice, like the narrator talking and not being someone in the screen, the voice also is not auricularized. It means that we hear it in the surround, we hear it everywhere. So auricularization, it's something that tends to separate diegetic from non-diegetic music. Non-diegetic music is not auricularized, and the diegetic normally it is. Okay. So, we saw some examples of music, and maybe we can play this Yorgo Pistve example, which is what we call an emanation music. So, emanation music is some kind of ambiguously diegetic. We don't know, it's not really there, but it's not really outside the image, but we don't see the source of this music. So sometimes, and that's the case for Yoseliani, it's used just to recreate what would be as a music in this scene. So here we have a mixture of you know, the sheep and the pigs with this music that we don't know if it is there or not. So we hear that and see, maybe in the next shot we will see the people who are singing. Thank you. So something that we kind of discussed last session was that emanation music is sometimes a bit confusing for the audience, no? Especially here when we see people speaking and maybe singing, and we don't hear what they are singing, rather we hear another music. So this could be uncomfortable for the audience sometimes. So in this case, Jose Reani makes it very clear that it's not a source music. So we agree once we enter there that it's a resource that he's using. I'd like to play you another example of music which is ambiguous, diegetically ambiguous. And in this case, it's different. It's a music made by what's his name? Max Steiner. And it's an early movie from the 40s, well, 1940. And in this case, both the diegetic and the non-diegetic music has been composed and recorded by the composer, Max Steiner. So here we have an ambiguity which is created and composed by the composer. So it's a bit different, but still here it becomes a resource. It becomes part of the language that the composer is using. So. I think the difference is more or less clear. We don't hear it very well, at least I can't hear completely. But there is some kind of superposition, overlaying of the two musics. And at the end, we clearly hear the change to be diegetic, and then we have the salon. We don't see actually the musicians, I think, playing, but we understand that now it's diegetic. So this is actually an innovation that Max Steiner made in this movie. I mean, it's really something that he explored and created this using like pop music or dance music in the score, and playing with when we are in one music or the other, and how it's ambiguous. Okay, I let you hear to the rest of the examples. Particularly nowadays, we have in the non-diegetic music a lot of usage of pop music, songs and all that. And when you play a song in a context where a song could be sounding, you never know if it is diegetic or non-diegetic. So this could be often a problem because it creates a confusion in the audience. Okay, I continue now. I mean, as for everyone, those who were Monday, those who are not. One example that I wanted to play, and we couldn't play properly last session, is what we call the change from an extended music, which is something that is diegetic. Sorry. That ends up being diegetic, but starts as non-diegetic. That means that it starts as non-auricularized, as a non-diegetic music, and then at some point it starts to be diegetic. So here we need really good listening conditions. So I'm going to play it, and what doesn't appear in the sound, you imagine. Okay?
Let's make it.
can't hear it completely, you perceive a change between the non-auricularized music, and then when we make it and it sounds like if it's playing on the radio or something in this case. So let's.
Well, here, this is
Good Morning in Vietnam. I don't know if you've seen it. I haven't really seen it all. I just wanted this example. As I was commenting with Marina, I can't stand Robbie Williams. Robbie, it's his name, sorry. But here we have this music that sounds everywhere, and we have changes in our equalization, but it plays in the radio station, so we have the original source of the music, and then in the different camps, and we are, when we are burning villages and people also, with happiness and good joy. So this is a way to say also that all happens at the same time. It's very important. As it is diegetic music, it creates a sense of continuity. So there is a compromise between the sound level and the feedback of the microphone. So another use of music that is interesting to understand is what I call the overlay diegesis or superimposed diegesis. That means that we have two scenes and the music from one scene goes into the other. So here we have an example of parallel scenes, so the two are happening at the same time. And the music from the first scene goes into the other, contains into the other. So let's see the first example, which comes from Homeland, which is a TV series about the CIA, and it's a question of spies, people who are spying one on another, and all the things that are complicated. So here they are spying the house of this guy, and they have to plug, to take off the microphones when they are at a church. So it's important to know that they have a very limited amount of time, that is the time that the others are not at home and they are at church. So let's play it.
Harry, are you ready? Come on, we only have all day, we're only going to be in church for like an hour and a half. We're on with this operation for fucking sake. You don't agree? It's not a real choice. Saul said that we kind of had a mistake and created that from the Inspector General.
Yeah, but what do you think?
I mean, you've been watching Bunny as long as I have, and that's an opinion. Look, we've been on for a month and we've come up empty.
Oh, well, what about Max? What is Max think?
He thinks his life is hot. Okay? Come on.
Thank you.
actually it's a non-diegetic use of the music because we increase the volume and the tension. Because now in this scene, in this place, it's where the guy they are spying has his muscling stuff, and probably she's going to find it. We don't know if she's going to find it or not, but it's now where the things are important. So,
Espíritu Santo, Espíritu
read in Spanish. So we have here the baptism in the church, the killers, the assassins, and those who are going to be killed. So you will notice that the killers, so they are the ones in charge and power, they have sound. So we hear the guns, we hear the clicks that they're making. The people who are going to be killed, they don't have any sound. And this is something that if you pay attention, you will notice in movies. The ones who don't have sound have no power, and the ones who have sound have power. At the same time, we have the music from the church that is overextended and sounds everywhere. So it gives also the fact that the ones in the church, the mafiosi, are controlling everything around. So it's a question of power. And it also gives us other information, like it's a religious music. Actually, it's not a religious music. It's a combination of musics. But it stresses the hypocrisy of those mafiosi who are very Catholic and very holy in a way, and then they are killing other people at the same time.
Santa la Iglesia Católica, Santo de Comunión, Revisión de Jumón, Dame esa reflexión de mi chile. Exorcízate con el Espíritu en nombre de Padres, Efini, Espíritu Santo. Purecia ser en chile, San Juan Pablo, Dei, Micaeli, y si en ti, y en el momento en que está hablando. Ebre, te pones Santa Tarire, que no los habitantes, tu bache en lugar de hierro y agua. Father, in your ancient name, Michael, you believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth?
Isaac.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord?
Isaac.
Do you believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church?
Isaac.
Father, most of the years in Chile, San David, Chitman, Amendo, Amelia, Benito, Nia, Pope, Pastor, Stephen, and Chelo, and Esteban. Father, most of the years in Chile, San David, Chitman, Amendo, Amelia, Benito, Nia, Pope, Pastor, Stephen, and Chelo,
Thank you.
Lord, peace, and may the Lord be with you. Amen.
Thank you.
theory, a diegetic music. We hear, we see how she puts the disc, the record on there. So this music emanates from her, and it's her music. So one point about that is that when we have diegetic music, usually it's not recorded with the music, so we don't have a direct sound from the music or whatever is playing or is supposed to be played. That's because when we have several shots to take, so we have the character. Yeah, we have the character. And we film the character, we film her in this position. Then we have another shot and we record it from this position. It's almost impossible to make the music be exactly synchronous. Speech is not a problem because, for instance, we record a character and she says blah, 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 and then we go there and someone replies blah, 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 and then blah, 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 blah. We can cut, there's a silence, we can cut, and we can end. So that's why the scenes were recorded without the music, and you will see some of the characters who seem to be dancing nonsense. No, they are moving, and the music is not really the exact rhythm. And that's because they are dancing without the music, and they say, "Well, you imagine that we have a music," and she's doing whatever she can. So she's not crazy, not deaf. She's just doing well, whatever she can. So there are other things that we're going to skip. But I wanted to show you something about the musical show. As often in many movies, we have an interruption of the story to play music, and the music becomes really a show. So often there is a change in the quality of the sound, and the music sounds as if we were playing a CD. So that's because we have just a hedonic use of the music. I'm going to play here an example where we are in a show room, and at the beginning the music sounds auricularized, and then when we have the real show, it becomes non-auricularized.
Siempre que te pregunto.
year was a very well known singer in Spain. I don't know if she's.
Yes, okay. She was quite well known in the 70s. In Soviet Union, so there were a couple of films with her.
Okay.
I'm not sure if the young generation
knows. You weren't born, probably. Then she became a monster, and. That's not the point. The fact is, she's a very bad actress and quite a good singer. Every movie where she was a succession of musical shows. So the sound is not realistic. We use another kind of sound. So here I'd like to play also some examples with classical music or other styles. And here it's a Japanese animation, Madame Cantabile, where there are about music students. So let's play the example.
Mm-hmm.
So what's interesting here is that actually it looks like a real direct recording where we have the real voices of the people and not a studio recording where the sound is perfect and the voices are perfect. Here it's because the singers are good enough for it to be recorded in real time. But this is a question also that is important when making a film. Should we use real sound? Should we use real musicians, even if they're not perfect? Or should we go to a studio recording of like high orchestras and professional singers? So it's a question that should be asked, especially for musicians. It's sometimes a bit frustrating to see that even when you are playing, you have a student playing something, the sound is perfect, and you have Yehudi Menuhin or Horowitz playing a recording, you know. So music, it's harder than that, and it's not just you play and everything sounds good. And here.
Arts.
So when When we use music in cinema, in audiovisual, it's always, that we want it or not, there will be an emotional information that will be brought. But also we have a lot of information about from where it comes, so the regional or location associations, and also about time. So we have time and space, and basically the orchestral music, the 19th century style romantic music with the romantic orchestra, is a music that we can call it cinematographic music or film music, and that can be used everywhere for every period and every location. There are other musics like contemporary music, which can be used in different places, but it has to be a recent period, something modern or futuristic. And folk music or music that is associated to a place will only work when associated with this place. Also, Baroque music or music before the 19th century will be associated with older periods. Okay, I just put in parentheses because I say that's for everywhere, but of course it's for mainly for Europe. But then who cares for things outside Europe, right? Then there is this associations of genre and style, and this is very, very, very important. Because usually the music sounds at the beginning of a movie or a TV series or anything. We start with music, then the story starts, right? So more important often than the image to determine the genre of the movie is the music. So if at the beginning you put a music, for instance, a song, because for commercial purposes you need to sell this song, then you are going to force the audience to watch this movie, with a different perception than if we had, I don't know, a dramatic music, etc. So it's very important, and often you have to fight to put the right music for the movie and not use something that is nice or pretty. A nice music and a pretty song can be a bad thing for a movie if it changes the genre as we perceive it. So here we have differences in orchestration, like large orchestra versus small orchestra. And I called here what José Nieto, a composer in Spain, a film music composer, calls the Bratislava syndrome. So no one dies from it, but it's something that has occurred in Spain in the late 90s and the early decade of the 2000 year. So it's now we can go and record in Bratislava, where they have very good studios, very good musicians, it's cheap, and we can have a large orchestra. So the composers, even if it is a small comedy, naturalistic, etc., have this huge orchestra, whatever the genre. So that's often a problem, because it's not because we can use a large orchestra, that a large orchestra is needed. So I don't know if you have, any of you have a Bratislava syndrome, but be aware of that. If it is a small comedy or a drama, an intimate drama, you should use a small ensemble. And then we have what we call the congruence. So there is the semantic congruence when the genre and the style and the period matches. Temporal congruence is more about the changes in the music correspond to changes in the image. And also something which is quite kind of important is the tempo. Tempo determines very much if it's congruent, and actually the scenes can have a tempo. And something which is different from congruence is empathy. So empathy is the fact that the mood, the emotion in the music matches or enhances the mood of the film. We can have what we call an empathetic effect when voluntarily we use a music that mismatches what we see. Okay? So, I don't know about empathy, but you seem a bit worn out. So feel free to ask questions and to do something, react. I hope I'm not sleeping you. So, let's start with empathy and information. So the music also, whatever the emotion or whatever the codes, the fact that there is music indicates that something important is going on. It doesn't matter the music. If we put a music here, ta-cha, it's because something is going to happen or what is happening is important. And then there is the empathetic or connotative function, which gives the mood, okay? But empathy is something a bit fluctuating, because when we have a scene with a music, usually, unless there is a complete mismatch, the music is going to tell us how we should see the scene. So, here we have what I call an analysis by modification, where I've taken a scene and changed the music. So the meaning of this scene kind of changes. So let's start. So this was Debussy, the orchestration of Satie's Jeanne d'Arc. And now here she seems, I don't know, in love, or, oh, my son, you've come back after all these years, or, I don't know, something like that. No? She these associations of music to regions or periods of time. But there are also some music which are codified. It's, one of them are the anthems, like La Marseillaise. It's the French anthem, and it's not because it sounds French, no? It's because we know that we have a catalogue of musics, which are the anthem of here, the anthem of there, and it's a code. So you can play with codes, and we will talk about it next session. And the same goes for the lullaby.
Rich, well endowed.
Let's say well endowed. With phlegm. Alright, let's go. It's bedtime.
The bed. That's all. Happens.
Come on, let's get you sorted out.
That night, Barney didn't take care of business. Instead, Nora took care of Barney.
So music, the music you listen, it defines you as a person, and in a movie, it's a very quick way to define the personality of someone. So I was just I found this example which I was just looking at, and I found it very interesting because it's like a very caricature role.
In the morning when the sun is shining, I will take a walk to King Marie. And there's a little meadow beneath the mountain shadow where I will meet the girl from King Marie. I love to hear a voice whispering that I'm her choice. I love the girl from King Marie. She's as pretty as can be. She belongs to only me.
Sheila.
Thank you.
Is it I don't know what I'm writing here, but I'm sure that can we make it speak Latin? Where?
Shift and alt.
Shift?
Alt.
Yes, shift what?
Shift alt, alt, plus alt.
Shift alt. Alt, yes.
Outside, okay. So, sorry.
So here we have, in this scene, it's the tempo is lento, but we can put a quicker thing because there is no action. But we are going to watch some other scenes where they have an inner tempo, and that's important when you are putting the music to a scene, is to control the tempo, the natural tempo it has. So, for instance, in my class, when one of the exercises is to put music on certain scenes, so I ask them to start the tempo of the scene in silence. Right? Detect the tempo and then choose a music that has this tempo. And it's kind of interesting because actually people agree in the tempo of the visual music. So here we have, for instance, a scene from Brazil where it has nothing to do with Brazil except that it has a samba music. But let's see it.
Suddenly, you become
become an observant and you reflect on the futility, the stupidity of the people and their lives. So, just to play an example, it's not very good, but I think it's kind of representative of when we are in the action and when we get out of the action. And here it uses a music of Arvo Pärt. Friday.
Thank you. Any questions? Anything you would like Blas to talk about next time? I'm a dancer for the two guys that are still in the book for Pima Panda Kafir. It's
more incredible.
Okay?
Okay, well, thank you for attending.